the associate director of Intel NTU Connected Context Computing Center. His research area spans from emerging applications that can utilize the true potential of Internet of Things to computer architecture that can emerge application. He is a steering committee member of IEEE International of Things Journal, the chair of Internet of Things Special Interest Group of IEEE Signal Process Society, and he is a deputy director in chief of IEEE Journal on Emerging and Selected Topic in Circuit and System. He also received his PhD degree from Princeton University, and he is an IEEE Fellow. So we can know Dr. Chen is very excellent scholar and very young. Today, his speech title is Manageability Challenge for Internet of Things. So please now put your hands together to welcome Dr. Chen.
Thank you, Professor Li, for the introduction. I told Professor Li she just need to say cheers to the speaker and I can introduce myself. She didn't want to do that. That's okay. But you know, a few things she said. You know, and the reason I don't normally like to put it, you know, as the whatever bio says, is may not be relevant to you. Because the other day I was trying to recruit a young engineer to join my team. And I start to tell her that, oh, I have done supplements, streaming, you know, instruction set, SAC3. And she looks puzzled, right? I think many of you in the audience probably feel puzzled as well, right? What does that mean? Is that important? Just like, you know, Bob in the morning talking about modem. Unfortunately, I think half of the room is still not too young to understand what modem means. So the same thing happened, right?
So today, you know, I try to do things slightly differently.
I want to first, you know,
introduce myself as a way to tell you why, you know, you should, you know, trust me as a speaker here.
I say, oh, I'm an IEEE fellow. Maybe that's the reason I get invited. But actually, that's
not important. The most important thing is I have around more than 80 connected devices. Oh, just like Bob, you know, we try to try things out. And furthermore, you know, besides, you know, writing papers, now actually I've started my, you know, third habit. Now actually I buy a lot of stuff from Amazon. And Amazon has millions of users. And about 2 million of users actually provides comments on the Amazon website. And people start to say, you know, I like your comments, I don't like your comments. And they start to rank the reviewers by how many people like your reviews. And now I start to collect my habits. Like now I want to say, you know, I'm the top 5% of Amazon reviewers because I buy so many devices and I start to critique or provide useful information where people want to buy their own stuff, right? So here's just the page showing that, you know, I'm top, you know, 5%. So the most important thing for you to remember, I want to say is, you should consider I'm a user that has more than connected devices in my house. And this connected device is actually the base for my presentation today. Okay? And how come I become a user? And then how come I want to share with you? Intel NTU Connected Computing Center is working on IoT, starting in 2011, where people are very vague about what's IoT. Even I was, you know, the associate director, somehow only very high level
theoretical understanding about our problem. Not until
last year, I took my sabbatical and I decided not to go anywhere for additional jobs, just decided to stay home for my sabbatical. And my wife, you know, I was talking to my wife and saying, what should I do? Right, my wife asked me, say, hey, you've been talking about IoT. Now is your opportunity. You know, think about what you can do at home. Okay? So that's how I started. You know, during my sabbatical, I start to try all the things in my house and to see where I can learn more besides, you know, theoretical papers, the real hand experience. And eventually this is what, you know, I have. You know, I basically have a bunch of devices in my house. You know, I can play around with it. And, you know, here's a, some of this, and these are even comprehensive. Okay, by the way, if I really tell you 80s, it's going to be, you know, a bunch of slides. And here's just a pictures of a few devices I happen to have, and I put it up as a picture. And to show you, you know, how incredible or how terrible my habit is, here's the, my, you know, front door. So basically, I have four cameras, three motion sensors, three infrared lights. It sounds like, you know, I'm heavily guarding my house, right? And unfortunately, the picture is slightly dark, so some of the things you cannot see, so just highlighted a whole bunch of different things. Even, you know, inside the door, I'm not sure in the back of the room you can see, actually there are three open and closed sensors. And there's no, actually no need to have so many sensors on it. The reason I have so many sensors is because I'm just doing my experiments, and I want to try it out, and try to test the limits. Okay, so that's it for the hardware. And then also on the software side, on my phone, I have a whole page on my iPhone screen. It's all about smart home related products and then the apps associated with it. And within that, SmartThings is the one I use the most. I have more than 80 connected devices. If I open it up, it's just pages or icon again. You know, I can tell, you know, what's there, right? So you can see now, at least I have a, you know, six water sensors to, you know, whether there's a leak, then I can be informed immediately. So that is, you know, my setup. And today, you know, I want to come here to share with you just my view as a users and how that, you know, changed the view. But before I do that, I want to talk about the definition, my definition of IoT. Different people have different definitions, right? And people are attractive to perform research on IoT. Many people in Taiwan probably heard about Maurice Chen, right? Last year he talked about IoT's next big things. So suddenly you can see a lot of companies start working on IoT. And a lot of companies start to form IoT alliance, right? Like Asus recently do that. But in 2011, we already start doing that. And there's a reason we want to do that. And there's a reason we continue doing that. So I want to talk about a little bit my definition of IoTs and make sure we are on the same page. And I will tell you, you know, what's the positive side of, you know, my experience and what's the sort of area for improvement when I was trying to test out my IoT. And I will drill down to the manageability challenges and what's the next step here. So what's, you know, IoT? You ask different people, they have different opinions. Today, if you go to Computex this week, right, today is probably last day, so probably I don't have a chance, but if you go there, you went there earlier this week, you go to the booth, then you consider what's the IoT. They probably, most of the time, they tell you, oh, my device can connect to your smartphone, and that is Internet of Things. Right. I don't think that's right thing to think about it, because I think this is the first step, but not enough. So that's why I call it only, you know, IoT 0.5. I do have many devices like that. For example, in I have a, you know, IP camera, and from my phone I can see what's going on in the house. But if there's something happens, it won't inform me. I need to go there and check every time. But if I'm out of the house and I at work, I won't be able to do that. Right? It's not a good device to think about. Similar things have, you know, this kind of, you know, lock. Right, when I'm away and you to my house and you are my good friends, I can just remotely open the door. But, you know, people may be able to hack into the system and make it useless as a lock. Right. And then, so the second you know, generations. That's what I used to call it, you know, second generation, but today I consider only 0.9. is now, since I connected, and then mostly to the cloud, now you can make intelligent decisions in the cloud to help you do more things. A good example is like a Dropcam, which is a company bought by Google. It streams all your videos to the cloud and start analyzing. And then actually it can adapt. You know, the user can provide feedback and then you can start tune the notifications based on what they want to do. And this, you know, decision can be improved, eventually only notify you when there's a very important event. I like the product. But you know, the more I think about it, well, there's still something missing. What something missing is, what I really want is a lot of devices, you know, heterogeneous, multiple connected devices are working together. Because when previously we were talking about this one, I think we probably can tell people called intranet of things. Means that within that same devices is connected. But once outside the devices, it's no longer connected. And lots of opportunity actually are not fully utilized when, you know, multiple different devices are working together. And I would say this is really IoT 1.0. And I'm going to give you an example. What does that mean? I have a, you know, smartwatch. Okay, this is not the latest one. It's not an Apple Watch. This is a watch that will be able to actually monitor the heart rate, monitor the skin temperature, okay, and then monitor step counts. It's sort of like a health device. I will be able to use it. And then again, you can see that this is a graph of one of the week early last year, right? And then you can see the graph is, you know, moving around. And most of the time, you know, this watch is not going to do anything. Only me going to handle the data. But if you watch carefully, actually there are few noise showing up here. It's basically the heart rate is beating higher than normal, right? What's that? Actually, I was getting the fruit, so I was sick. So all my temperature or my heart rate actually went up for a couple of days when I was sick, right? So it's pretty obvious now. From my perspective, yes, I was sick, so that's why this, you know, biosignals all go up. But at that time, the device did not inform me, right? I wish there would be a more useful things when this is connected to the next one. And an example is I have a very simple called heat disk. And the whole idea is that once you power on, it generates heat. And I was getting a slight fever, so actually I want a warmer room than normal, right? So I put this one into my room, and we try to warm it up. But unfortunately, it does not have very accurate temperature sensors. So I can only turn it on until I feel too hot, then I go to turn it off. And then feel that too cold, then I go to turn it on, right? This is not the habits you really want if you are considered you are, you know, 21st centuries human beings, and you, everything should be smart to help you, right? So what can I do? So when everything is connected to the internet, here's what I can do. I put out a temperature sensor, and then I use a website called If Less Than That, called IFTTT. And this, you know, IFTTT can do the triggering, means that okay, if above certain threshold, turn this prox switch on. So I just plug this dump, you know, heat disk into that. And this makes it smarter. So at the end is I have a very compelling usages for my devices now. Right. Now when they are connected to the internet, now I can control it to whatever temperature I like. And I don't need to worry about not getting warm enough. Okay. So lots of story can go on. Right. This is just a picture, so overlapping with previous slide I showed you that different devices have. some of the devices can be integrated into the hub, some of the devices into the web. And the more devices they can do, actually there are more compelling usages. Right. A very unique example I can share with you recently is I have a sprinkler controller. In the US, most of the single family house have grasses in the garden. And you know, you need to water the grasses, otherwise they get dried and they get dyed. And your neighbor will complain, you know, how come you didn't maintain a beautiful garden for everybody to enjoy it? So we need to, you know, water the grass and when it's needed, right? And there's a smart, you know, sprinkler controller called Rancho now, selling on Amazon. And what happened is you consider, oh, this is smart, you know, it can do do the moisture, you know, monitoring of the grass and decide whether to water it. Or you can read out the weather forecast. If tomorrow is going to rain, you can save your water, don't water it, right? But the most amazing one today, what they announced is, actually they work with the smoke detector. When the smoke detector senses there's a fire emergency, what happened is you will turn the sprinkler on and make sure, you know, your family is well watered surrounding. So at least prevent, you know, the fire spread to the next house, right? But in the past, if you don't have this one, you never think about how come the sprinkler can be connected to the smoke detector. Well, today, smoke detectors in the house, in the US house, mostly are not connected. So there's no way you can do that. But once, you know, they start to connect it to the internet, and then people will start having very compelling usages to make it even more interesting. Okay, so that is, you know, my view, and then actually I can tell you the positive side of, you know, my experience in my house is I got a lot of, you know, smart home usages out of it, right? Such as security and access control. I show you that I have lock and you have a bunch of motion sensors in my house will open and door, open and close sensors. So when I out of the house, those devices become alarm system. If some intruder was working in my house, the system will tell me immediately, right? But when I was in the house, and actually is doing things differently, in particular, is doing a lot of utility management. It will control the lighting, right? When I, you know, walk in the room and it's dark, the light will turn on automatically. When I walk out, and then I forgot to turn the lights off, it will turn the light off for me automatically. So it can reduce the energy usages. Similar things like, you know, climate control, right? What's the temperature in the house, the garden, and so on. So the goal is to minimize the energy, water, or natural gas, you know, usages if you can do all the control smartly. And all others like healthcare, assisted living, right? Now, my watch will know my heart rate, my temperatures, my scale, actually can monitor, you know, how over the time my weights keep going up or keep going down, or my blood pressure, right? Everything now can be all connected and then provide way much more information than we can do. And of course, there are others like, you know, audio, video, or entertainment systems, like, all can be connected together. A simple example is like Amazon Echo, which is a device will play the music to you most of the time. But besides playing the music to you, actually with the push of buttons, I can start to speak to it, and it will start taking my control, right? And you will be able to even necessarily order, you know, the products if I need, right? So these are all, you know, all the smart home usages we can think about. And I think it's probably too small for the people in the back to read, but the whole idea is now the capability in my house, including automatic control, means that the system will be able to control itself, or remote control where I put up my smartphone, I will be able to do it. For example, if I want to open the garage door and so on. I can do it from here. Or there are a bunch of automatic notifications. Basically, it's monitoring the system and tell me if something's wrong and I need to pay attention. Or I can do remote monitoring. It means I open my smartphone, I can now go back to watch in the videos. Now it's streaming from the garage to understand what's going on. Right. So that's all about the positive side, you know, in my house. But what are the challenging sides? You know, when I was trying this, you know, 80 plus devices in my house. Number one, I would say installation is a challenge. Here's an example. Oh, sorry, it's probably too dark, so you won't be able to see that. I want to install open and close sensor. Well, previously I showed you a few pictures, just tape it outside. That was because I started getting lazy, right? But the first one I installed, actually I want to put in inside the door. So it can be high inside the door if I know how to do it right. So actually I need to drill a bunch of hole on the side of the door and then make it even bigger hole. Eventually I can put the sensor in and then I can seal it, you know. And unfortunately for people in the back or even people in the front probably don't see how I seal it, right? When I was doing that, some people give me advice. You can seal very nicely and even, you know, with paint. You can paint it so nobody can see, you know, you have a sensor inside. But at the last moment I decided not to do that because I realized, hey, it's a battery powered. If I seal too well and then, you know, 6 months later I need to change the battery, it's going to be really painful. So eventually I'm using just a piece of white tape, you know, on top of it. So when I want to change it, at least I can easily peel it off and then change the battery. Right? That's the side of one side of the story. Basically, I have a physical space challenges. You know, I'm not a carpenter, which is know how to, you know, cut the wood very nicely. If you see that, you know, this is not very nicely cut, right? This is because by amateur. And a lot of things I need to install is also related to electricity. So I'm not a, although I have a double E degree, right?
Well, I can even say it loud, I have a PhD in double E, but I was never a certified electrician. Right? So I was worried about one day my house, you know, caught fires and the insurance company, you know, refused to pay. Because how come you have some non-certified electrician doing something to the wiring of the house? Right. So, but that's the physical challenges. What's the real challenge to me? Actually, the cyberspace challenges. People never think about it. They think, you know, the physical space is a big challenge. But as, you know, we, as, you know, double ECS background, so all, you know, the double ECS actually is the easy part. Actually, it's not. You know, when I was doing the installations, most of the challenges I have is how can I add the device to the system. It often takes me, you know, at least half minutes to do it. You don't think about it as a big problem, right? But when you have 80 devices and half minutes for that is a huge. And furthermore, sometimes even worse, one of the products is Wink. It's terrible. Normally it takes 3 to 4 trials and you don't make it up. And so I actually have a very good example and demonstrate how hard it was. My family moved from one house to another house in December last year. When we moved, I took down all the devices and put it up in the new house. It took me a week to reconfigure everything back to normal. Okay, it's literally a week. Because everything I need to do is like, you know, 1 minute again, right? And then every day, if I struggle more, some of the devices take 5 minutes and just 1 week to do that, right? So people never realize it's also very painful if you want to do, you know, lots of work in the cyberspace. And the second one, the pain point I want to talk about, which is about user behavior, right? The user behavior here is sometimes
the companies are so innovative, and then they forgot the users, still the existing users. Okay, here's an example. These are the two connected light switches you can install in the back of the wall. Okay, one is from Belkin. I think most of people probably know the company. It's more like IT company. And the other one is from GE. Probably, is, you know, we understand it's more traditional, you know, electrical companies. And their design is totally different, right? And from this one, I would say, oh, it's really friendly to the normal user, because actually they provide all the wires. All you need to do, just, you know, find the right wires and then just using the cap to tie the loose end wire together. So you not much to do. But this one, they provide you no wires. You think about it now, you need to figure out how to plug in the right wire to the right places. You know, this is a problem, okay? But the bigger problem now, I'm gonna flip it to the other side, which is the front of the switches. The front of this switches actually is a single button switches. And this is like a traditional. Means that if you tap on the top part, it turns on. Tap on the button up, button half, it turns off. Right? This is not most of the switches you have experience. Unfortunately, this one is completely different. Basically, tap on it. If it's on, it becomes off. Tap on it. If it's off, become on. And the first thing you need to understand, if it's on, it's off. In particular, if you install this one inside the house and then the light is outside the house, now you need to watch. So it actually changed the behavior. And furthermore, I have a huge complaint to the company. I think some of my negative, you know, feedback, when people don't like my feedback, is when I complain. Okay, I complain. Once for a while, when I open my apps, you tell me there's a new firmware. Do you want to update it? Hey, I think people from using the, you know, your computers, you got used to when computer asks you, hey, there's an update. No matter it's Java or the Microsoft Office updates, do you want to download it? Fine, you got used to it. But if you're talking about switches, you ask me whether you want to update the firmware, I think you're asking too much. Okay. That's something that I don't really like. And just an example of light switches, right? The other one, let me see. I'm gonna use this example, changing the behaviors. Right, this is just a simple example that a light switch is, you know, different company, a different philosophy. You can see the difference. Another one is Philips Hue. I'm not sure how many people heard about the term, but the idea would be the intelligent LED light bulbs. Now you can put multiple color into it. And then you can use it to tune it so that, say, today I want to relax. I can use it in a softer color. Or today I want to concentrate. I want to read the paper. I need to review it, right? And then I'm so tired. So turn on a much brighter, and they even call it energetic mode to make sure you don't fall asleep, right? That particular light bulb is pretty genius. I think it's pretty good. But one of the biggest assumptions is it has to be always with power. When without power, then you get a problem. And any people here, then you get past, yes, most of the light bulb need power. Yes, that's right. But the problem is, most of the times when you want to turn off the lights, you go to the switch, you turn it off, right? When you turn it off means there's no electricity to the light bulb. So in order for you to control all the lightings, you know, for the Philips Hue, they give you apps on your phone. And when I first installed it, okay, I used my iPhone to turn the light bulb off. But when my wife, you know, come to the room, you say, wait, the switch is already on, the light bulb is off. The light bulb must be broken. Or sometimes, you know, I leave it on, right? And then my wife, you know, want to close, shut down the lights. So she go to the light switches and tap it off. And when I want to turn it on, hey, how come? Something wrong? Oh, yeah, because there's no electricity connected to the light bulb. So it's completely break, you know, human common practice, right? You want to change the, you want to turn on the light on and off, there's a switch on the wall. And then don't rely on you to use the iPhone to do it. Otherwise, they're going to fight with each other. It's just completely, you know, different story when you go to that. And then when you, you know, ask user to change behavior, you got a lot of problem. Right? And the second one is, you know, what I do a lot is I like to, you know, as I experience it, I like to put in the devices to different places, in particular light bulbs. Sometimes I put it here, and the next day I say, maybe this light bulb is better shooting later. So I start changing it. And more, you know, the example I tell you about, you know, when I move my house from one to the other one. Right, when I move the house from one to the other one, I forgot to label all the devices carefully. So the light switches in the living room may become the family light switches in the next house. The motion sensor in the kitchen may become the motion sensor in the living room. And when I do that in the first house, I say, you know, living room light, motion sensor, turn on living room lights. I can do that easily. But when I go to the next house, now I need to remember, I need to refigure out where are the sensors are and where the switches are. And because, you know, today's most of the rules are associated with the name, ID, or even MAC address of the devices, not associated with the location, the physical location. But when human want to set up the rules, say, turn on and turn off, they are talking about the physical location and the physical associations, not really the name, the ID address. So if I pull out my iPhone, you will see now, you know, if you see, you know, new living room lights, new whatever, you know, I put a new in front of it, means that I already figured out this is already in the new house, right? It's terrible because I now need to redo the associations. And this, you know, require name addresses. This has become a problem, right? And then we now, with everything, this is not a good behavior. And this third, you know, pain points I want to point out actually is about sensitivities. Too sensitive or too insensitive actually create a lot of trouble. My most famous example I used to tell people is last December, my whole family, after, you know, 2 weeks of moving to the new house, we come back to Taiwan for family vacation. And the first thing is I turn on my iPhone, I realize, oops, my siren in the house has been sound for 6 hours because there's a false positive of a motion sensor seeing someone in my house. When everybody is out of the house and seeing there's a motion sensor, the siren turned on. And normally if I'm in the US, right, or at least, you know, in Taiwan now I have 3G connections, I can, of course, I can check it, and then if nothing, I can turn it off. But I was on the airplane for 12 hours, and in the middle of that, a siren got triggered, and sound for 6 hours. So my friend told me that you become very famous in the neighborhood, right? Then this new neighbor will come in to decide to share, you know, his home security system with everyone, but 6 hours of siren, nonstop. Hey, so the first things I do is turn it off, right? But this sensitivities, unfortunately today, is very hard to adjust. And some of the vendor give you a knob for you to adjust it, but there's no good feedback system to tell you how it was out. Obviously, it's almost impossible to adjust the sensitivities. And some of you may know already, right? The motion sensor did not work well if you sit still. I'm not sure how many of you have been in the conference room with a motion sensor. In the middle of the discussion, the lights suddenly turn off. You know, at Intel, we see that happened. And even in my house, right, my wife was reading the story to the kids, and it would turn off as well. And I got complained a lot. And sometimes the motion sensor was specified, you know, by the size of the image, means that, you know, how big is, you know, the object you've seen image. But sometimes I don't want that. I just want to tell the range. Even, you know, for example, I have some motion sensor in the front door. And sometimes a big truck, you know, going through the street will trigger the motion sensor. And which is, I don't care because it didn't come to my house. But if, you know, a mailman or someone else try to steal the mail and so close to the front door, I want to know. Unfortunately, the motion sensor did not have the right adjustment for that. But it based on the size of the image. So the big truck is more, has a bigger size than the human beings. Right? So these are the all sensitivity problems. And ideally, what we want is for user to specify some ideas, and then the machine learning to fine tune it. Then another example, let me tell you another example is, one time I was trying to do the light switches based on the luminance. Basically, you know, it's dark and I can do it, right? I set the threshold with, you know, 30,000. I don't know where the 30,000 come from, but I think I get the readings. I think it's pretty, you know, good. But one point, I was, you know, seeing, you know, the light keep on and off, because it's about the boundary. And the light switches only know the rules about 30,000, and keep doing that. It's quite annoying. Hey, I got to change another one. But what would be the right one? I have no idea. What's 30,000 means? What's 20,000 means? Right? There's no way I can associate with it. So the better way to do it, actually, is not to use it. So eventually I gave it up and I use another one, say, you know, when there's a sundown and then you start doing that. But actually it's not really what I want, right? Now every day, you know, after 6 p.m., even outside still pretty bright, my light may turn out, right? Which is I don't really want. And what I want is tell the system when it's dark and when I walk in the room, turn on the lights. Can we do that? The day, you know, none of the existing system can do that. And I think this is some machine learning can help us to do that. You know, when I tell the system when it's dark, turn on the lights for me, and then you will eventually know what do I mean by dark, right? If I keep telling him, say, hey, turn it on, eventually we'll know, okay, about this threshold, you should turn it on. And it should not turn on and off, you know, within very short distance. Right. So, the fourth one I want to talk about is this device failures. I got more than, you know, 52 devices, right? A year. You know, every year there are 52 weeks, right? And within 52 weeks, you know, let me play it back. Right. Consider, right, if you have a device and it will fail, you know, once every year, but when you have more than 52 devices, you can consider on the average one device will fail a week in your system. Right. And that's the problem I'm getting into. Now I have more than 80 devices. Every week, on the average, I will have one device fail. And when it fail, it start to do things that, you know, unexpected. Sometimes my wife would complain, say, hey, how come I walk in the room, the light did not turn on? Because she's so used to the light will turn on automatically. Or sometimes she walk out of the room and half hour later, the light's still on, right? Hey, how come you are wasting energies, right? Well, sorry, it's not my fault. I think it is somehow the system is not working on the correct behaviors. And we run into a lot of troubles by, you know, having the system in the house. And more devices I have, the more, you know, device failures I can experience. And today, most of the devices are using Zigbee and Z-Wave. In my experience, they are not really stable, and then furthermore, it's even harder to debug it. And sometimes it's even hard to debug a faulty device. Sometimes because can be because of battery, because other reasons, the device is not communicating. Sometimes easy, you know, you just, you know, hard reboot it, take out the battery, put it back. Sometimes you cannot do that, right? It's, you know, really hard to debug devices. And the worst case, in my opinion, is there's not enough I/O for the bucket. Right? Here's many people with VECS degree. You understand if you want to debug a program, you know, let's say talk about the maybe not even the first year freshmen already do better. Let's say high school students, when they want to debug it, probably say, hey, you know, put some printf there, you know, tell you what's going on, right? And then why printf is important? It can tell you the information. But you consider now these devices have limited I/O. How can you debug a device with limited I/O? So what we need is actually have the system to avoid you need to debug it. Okay? So I talk about the challenges side of my home IoT. Now let's talk about the managing challenges. I have many other stories I can share. One example I'm going to share is, you know, consider I have 80 devices.
Right. And then these are the open and closed sensors, and one of them it stays open. Now the question is, hey, what does this mean? Is the front door? Or is it garage door? I can tell you which one. You know, when I, you know, show the apps to my friends, I can tell which, you know, corner means what. But my friend is always amazed. Hey, how can you know that? Well, I can remember it today. But the biggest problem is I may not remember all day tomorrow. Right. Well, I'm getting really old, so I don't remember a bunch of things.
But the truth is, my wife don't know either. My kids don't know. Right? So there got to be a better way to you know what's going on. And then an easier example is that every week I was trying to debug the system. Sometimes a simple reboot will solve the problem. Sometimes I need to do a much more dramatic changes. Means I need to take the devices out of the network and put the device back to the network. Right. Just you know, very similar to all kinds of problems we have been experiencing. But when I want to put all you know devices out of the network, I need to delete it. And in order to delete it from the system has a safeguard mechanism. Means if you already have some smart rules associated with it, for example, this motion sensor will control the lights. You cannot delete the motion sensor out of the system without first delete the rules. Right? I think they're pretty smart. But the problem is, now I have a device, maybe have 4 or 5 rules associated with it. In order for me to do a second level hard reboot, meaning I take out network and put it back, I need to write down all the 4 or 5 rules associated with it. And I can take it out, and I can put it back. Now I need to manually add all the 4 or 5 rules back. Could even introduce some problem associated with it. And but that, you know, process take tens of minutes to do it, right? So my observation is don't assume all the devices will not have any faulty state at all, right? Devices are likely to run into a faulty state, right? Communications, batteries, all kinds of problems. Devices have limited user interface, and the user actually are not interested. Maybe as an engineer, I may be interested. But for my wife, for my kids, they're not interested. Just name one. So the true story is the system should still run no matter what happened. But can we do that, right? And I can do it today when I have 80 devices, but what if I have 300 or 400 devices? And is 300, 400 devices is a big problem? Well, Gartner says, right, the IoT unit will grow 30x from 2009 to 2020. And just take 2015 in the middle, I extrapolate saying there will be a 5x from the day 2020. So by the end of the decades, I assume my house will have more than 300 devices. You must be kidding me. I will be able to remember everything. I will be able to deal with it. One device fail every day. Okay? Think about if every...
A device fails once a year. I have a device to deal with every day.
Can I do it? That's impossible. Right? And when we look back, as we call device management today, the solution today, actually what the device management to most of the company today are connecting the device to a centralized console. Meaning I have a cloud, I have a web interface. I give you this web interface to you so you can monitor all your devices. That's what they talk about device management. Right? Oh yes, it's pretty nice. You can do remote device management, remote config, remote monitoring, remote diagnosis and maintenance. Pretty nice. Right. They even provide security, they even help you with the data coming in, help you analyze data. I think pretty nice. But the challenge is, this requires, number one, very heavy-weighted hardware in order for you to do that. Most of the devices I have, $50 or less than $50, have not much remote connectivity capability. And then they put everything in the cloud. So if I don't have a connection to the cloud, I have a trouble. And the user interface are not really friendly because pretty much they give you a database. Now you are the owner of the database, you need to deal with it. And then in order for you to change the device, actually it's have a lot of user efforts. Right. I can tell you a little bit more as an example for this one is Intel and City of Beijing. As a collaboration for the air quality monitoring. There are 300 devices, air quality monitoring devices they deploy together. But because the air quality is so good, so need to clean the filters constantly. Okay. The best way to do it is not to take down all 300 and clean them and put it back. So they figure out a very smart way, saying out of 300, let me make another 30. And every week, I have a technician go up to change this 30, replace one tenth of the filters. And I go to different places, rotating. So eventually, at least, you got evenly distributed. But the problem is when you need to put the devices on, you got to know what's the ID of this device. Now it's with this location. I take the device down, I need to remove it from the database. And besides the human effort, I talk about the physical space challenges, a bunch of cyberspace challenges as well. If you put the wrong address, suddenly you will get a reading.
You consider you're going to read the east side of the city.
It will tell you the west side of the city is on the air quality. And you're going to confuse people. So you got to make sure you do the right things. And then the whole bunch of cyberspace just maintaining their So I think there's a good research opportunities to do that. And the observation we have is human effort actually is the key bottleneck in terms of scalability when you go to big scales. The research hypothesis could be if we build inside intelligence in the middleware, then we can minimize the effort. The research questions, to be more precise, is can the middleware between this cyberspace and physical space, can it automatically configure the system? Can the middleware automatically monitor the system, right, without overloading the data channel? Can the middleware automatically diagnose and maintain the system, right, basically provide you an automatic failover, right? Can the middleware, dynamic distribute the workload for optimum resource efficiency? These are the kind of research suddenly to ask ourselves. And today I just want to share as an example what we have done at Intel NTU Center called Wukong. This is a proactive management framework. Basically, you do device discovery, device identification, and then try to understand the user needs, and then compose the service based on what devices you have and what the user needs. And then once it deployed, you are constantly monitoring and updating the service as necessary. Okay, and this is the, everything is this kind in the intelligent middleware, and with three framework called profile parsing progressions. I'm not going to go to detail, but I'll give you a user perspective. And the users here want to control a whole bunch of devices we call sensor node. And for people who have more ancient culture, probably understand Sun Wukong has a capability, right? When you pull the hair and put the hair and pull the hairs out, they become small monkeys. And what we try to say is, yes, there should be a master that control all these little monkeys. And in the cloud is what the applications that all the users want to talk to. It doesn't really want to, you know, talk to the individual devices. And from a developer perspective, when you want to develop new applications, we hope that we will be able to make it easy.
Just, Bob is shaking his head, I don't know why. We don't, you know, make it easier. Maybe you think this is not easy. The idea will be, you know, you just give me the simple step, tell me the stress of what you want. Right? And then click and draw, this one, is all you need to do to, as a programmer. And what, from the Wukong master perspective is, now, every time you have the programming logic in the cyberspace, you'll be mapping to the physical space automatically, based on certain cost function or certain constraint you want to have. Right? This, you know, from the cyberspace to physical space mapping would handle all the troubles we have. And in short, you know, we want to provide abstractions sit between the cyberspace and physical space. Basically, we want the users to program on a high-level, hardware-independent construct, not the physical devices. And then we're using the capability called auto-configurations. So basically, the middleware will intelligently map the logical relation to the physical devices. So you just consider, I will give the system a rule, say living room lights should, living room motion sensor should turn on the living room lights. That's all I need to do. So even I, you know, misplace different motion sensor, misplace different light switches in there, it doesn't matter because I never specified the physical MAC address or the object. Instead, I was talking about the logical relationship. So when I do that, I will be able to write it once, means I program it once and run everywhere. And furthermore, when a device fails or getting replaced, the only thing need to be done is done by the middleware automatically, meaning remap the relationship. So the example I talked about earlier when I replaced 30 out of 300 air quality sensors, I don't need to go to the database to change the relationship because the middleware should already do it for me. So it's supposed to be wrong, deploy once, wrong forever. And auto configuration just a way to figure out there's one relationship between your requirements and what the system can do. But you can come up with a bunch of optimization criteria. For example, you want to have a shortest latency, or your minimum bandwidth, or even longest battery life. So we can, among many configurations, try to even do auto-optimization. So that's the concept we have. And I want to borrow a term called software-defined from the previous keynote. I think there's a war of, you know, software-defined IoT. It's everything. You know, you should not think about the hardware, you should think about in the software. And the middle will be able to help you to do the job. Okay? And there are additional future work I can also share with you. Today I'm using the system. I tell you that I was sick, so I want the system to do it. But why do my system tell me I'm sick? I need to be stay warm. Today, you know, a system cannot do that yet. Right? I tell you about that. The other one is another thing that very easy false alarm in my house is sometimes when we get out of the house, we turn on the robots to clean the floor.
But unfortunately, the robot itself emits heat. So when we're out of the house, and when the motion sensor see there's a heat walking around the house, I think there's an intruder. Suddenly, my alarm turned off. Right? Ah, this is terrible. Right? So why? And in order to avoid that, I often need to manually turn off the alarm system. But this is terrible. And then, and my living room will turn off in 15 minutes later. This example is that, in order to minimize the complaint, my wife to me, right? How come I'm reading a book to the kids and the lights turn off? A way to do it is I using the threshold, which is at least 15 minutes, or maybe 30 minutes now. What it means that once it sends the motion, it will turn on the lights for at least 15 minutes. So even if it sits still for 15 minutes, I won't get a complaint until 60 minutes. So I only get complaint at least, at the most, 4 times an hour, if they sit there. Right? If I do it, like, you know, every 3 minutes, turn off the lights, I've got 20 complaints an hour. But that's a problem, right? Because maybe they really finished reading the stories, but then the lights still need to be on for another 15 minutes. Right? So it's not really good way to do the system. And another way for the system to know whether I'm in the house or when I'm in the house, they're using a cell phone or a token to track me. Right? A cell phone is easy. When you go to your house, your Wi-Fi is associated with it, and you know you're right home, or based on the GPS. A token is based on the beacon, means that it emits either Zigbee or Bluetooth, and you talk to each other, know you're home. And when you're in the right house, your house automatically disarmed. When you leave the house automatically armed. But I need to have a token. Can I do other things so I don't need a token? Right? And that's a why, and then why should I, you know, what else do I want? Actually, these two, the 5 stages of IoTs I want to talk about. Actually, I think that at the beginning, we can only do, you know, monitoring, maybe a slow control. But later, we see a lot of monitoring, instant control, via user predefined rules. Such as today, I can do that, right? And then the next step will be, can the monitor and control by the rules then by the machines, right? We talk about, like, you know, when I mean stock, what does it mean? Right. And then can we do even predictive control by anticipatory reasoning? A lot of people probably know this example. Air conditioning company is now selling the feature, right? Before you arrive home, you can use your cell phone to turn on the air conditioning. So when you arrive home, you don't feel so hot, right? But, you know, if your smart home know your directions, you probably know how many minutes you arrive home. Why cannot it automate that, right? Why do you need to tell it, right? And then in the future, maybe even more, we call proactive control and monitoring, right? And example is like, you know, today you have a smart meter, you know how the energy monitoring, so you start know how you control the lights, but now the AC in the rooms and so on can be controlled. And the next is the one that, you know, start learning your preferences. And the thermostat that will know when you come home is what, you know, need to be done. Maybe, you know, in the future, the thermostat that will test your boundaries. You know, suddenly turn the heat on, heat higher than the normal. And if you don't complain, it's probably a good indicator. This is probably your preference. Second?
They do in front.
They do in front.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Don't boil the frog in the cold water, right? Okay, so this actually is everything we call kinetic computing. You need to get more contacts to be connected and then doing things together. This is what Intel Intuitive Center is about, and this is what, you know, we imagine the future will go. In short, summary, very short summary, is we believe IoT will be next big thing. It's not because Maurice Chen says that. Okay, it's because we really think it will be, and it will significantly change our life, right? Collaboration among heterogeneous devices is the key. Today, I think, you know, many isolated solutions, I will only call it intranet of things, but if we're going to go to internet of things, means that, you know, different devices need to work together. And when we get to the large scale, we believe there's an opportunity in the middle layer that will be able to help people and to eliminate all kinds of human efforts. And I'm talking about this not from a research point of view, from a home user point of view, right? Because I feel a lot of pain there. If you want to contact me, here's my email address. I think if you Google it, you'll be able to find all kinds of my contact information. Okay, here's my presentation, and I want to entertain some questions. And by the way, I bring some gifts, Intel small gifts for people who ask questions.
Have any question?
Okay, Bob.
Okay, comment. I just want to say the British did a lot of research in this.
What?
They used, I don't know if the symbol stat, the acronym stands for, but B-U-T-L-E-R.
B-U-T-L-E-R?
B-U-T-L-E-R was the acronym.
Okay. I'm not familiar with that.
Pronounce it. Butler.
Butler. Yes. Okay.
But the butler had a lot more context.
Yes, yes. So very good point. Actually, when we think about it, indeed, for people who didn't recognize the term as me the first time, Kokwanjia, especially in England, many people have butler, those, If you watch the
Batman movie, right, remember, he's a butler. No, everything. Right, all the context. Yes, indeed.
And the problem is, Butler is always wanted. You know, do what you want to. So there's, a lot of lessons in my column. It's called not scripted. It goes into difficulties.
Yes, and lots of lots of research to do. Yes. Okay, but what do you want? I have a few more here. Okay, so we'll keep. Okay, next question.
Is there any new product, IoT product from Intel, and what's the plan for the IoT product?
Okay, sure. If you guys don't mind, use this opportunity to do some advertisement. Intel is working heavily on IoT. Starting 2 or 3 years ago, actually Intel formalized a business unit called IoT Group. Okay, it's one of the business group like similar to where we will sell PC or servers. It's in parallel to that. Intel have a few things that we are selling, from the processors, like Curies, Edisons, Galileos, other processors that we want to sell into the wearables or the IoT devices of it, with much more power efficiency, much smaller space, and you can even use cold cell battery to power the devices, to power the processors. That's one. And the other one is now we start to realize also this opportunity in the gateway. Also, all the software infrastructures from the device to the gateway to the cloud, including the security solutions. So Intel owned company called Wind River, who used to provide an embedded operating system for the embedded devices. Now actually they start to work with another company owned by Intel called McAfee. To now have this middleware together to bring the device gateway and cloud together. And Intel also owns some of the company in the cloud as well, called Capera, and provide API and will provide some of the analytics. Basically, when you collect all the data to the cloud, now start analyzing the data for you. A very good example is like predictive maintenance. All the motors, everything can turn as motors. And those motors will eventually wear and tear, means that the vibration of the motors will become dramatically larger than used to be. So if you have that vibration information, keep constantly analyzed, and eventually figure out, oh, it starts to do more than normal. Maybe it's time to call the mechanics to come in to look at it before eventually having a problem. Right. So these are the things that you can do in the cloud. So Intel is now want to actually provide a lot of solutions, but also want to work with many other companies. By the way, I will have to say is, I don't believe any single company can do it alone. So Intel actually have many alliance or consortiums. There are two lists I know. One is called Open Internet Interconnect Consortiums. Basically try to define the standards so different devices from the different vendors can easily work together. Okay? And there's another one called Industrial IoT Industrial IoT Consortium. And this is with GE and other companies who want to together help the industrial side of IoT. Today I'm presenting more like a home or end user side, but there's another side, it's more like the industrial side, like smart factories, right? And that is another consortium. Consumer electronics side, very good question. I'm not so sure anything I can announce it today, okay? But there are lots of things we are working on. A good example is Intel now is pushing the real sense technology, basically 3D cameras, and help you to do a lot of things in the past very hard to do. That can be considered one of them. But other technology, I probably have to check how much I can tell, or how much is still a research project. Thank you for your question.
Yes, following question. So, will Intel pursue a consumer environment with chipsets that support IoT?
Okay, for people who didn't hear Steve's question, there is will Intel pursue a product in the consumer electronics space? Is that the question? I have to struggle a little bit here because sometimes I can tell things already announced. Sometimes I cannot tell people something that we haven't announced yet. So, good question. I probably have to go back and check. And then I can tell you, upfront, probably is the answer is yes, we will. But I don't know which products we will announce.
Okay, and then one more question. It is somewhat sensitive, but in the past I've worked with Intel and large corporations, and I worked with their project structure, where they fund activities, and then when the money runs out, they cancel the project, and everyone's looking bad because I have a customer that was dependent on the product. Is Intel going to change their business strategy for IoT so that if this doesn't roll out as fast as everybody anticipates, that Intel will still be there?
Okay, this is even harder question for me. I don't know. To be honest with you, I think Intel made some mistake in the past. Intel tried to learn from the mistake. Okay, so today's our CEO has really different view and different strategies than the previous CEO. So maybe this CEO will be bored, maybe willing to be more patient. So maybe the last mistake will be today's mistake.
Okay. You talked a lot about IoT from the user's perspective and suggest maybe a proactive managed network or a new network could be a solution that best fit the user's experiences. But you also mentioned that you need a new middleware, a lot of things, maybe a server, and some the context rules, a lot of things. So to me, it's more like a heavyweight solution. But our starting from scratch, okay, here we have a full employment of IoTs. It's actually a transition phase, okay. So do you have any light solution, lightweight solutions, okay, for people that can are, let's say, easily install maybe some small scale internet or network in their home. Okay, so yes, this is the first question. And the second one is, so besides the factor of the, besides the technological factors, what do you think is still missing, in the missing piece, in the IoTs, in this chip puzzle, jigsaw puzzles, in particular from the user's experiences?
Okay, very good question. The first part actually is easy. Today in Taiwan, maybe not so many people do lots of DIY at home, right? One point is I was asking the audience, maybe we can do a simple poll. How many people change the lock in their house before? Okay, Bobby. Different way to change locks, they basically take out the lock and the physical lock on the door, right? How many people has done that? Okay, okay, good. So you can see, only a subset of people doing it, right? In the U.S., actually, a lot of people, right, are very hands-on. So they do a lot of changes by themselves, And a lot of DIY in the U.S., okay? So actually, even the home, Home Depot or Lowe's, these are the company who are selling the end user tools to change your house, now start to sell home automation devices. So actually those are a good collections of the devices people can start easily. You go there, buy a package, about $300-$400, they give you 10 devices, you can start using it. That's very simple. But I think the bigger challenge is also associated with the second question, is how scalable it is. Because you don't want to spend another $500 and then throw this $300 US dollars system away, because in the future, you need a bigger system. What you want is from this $300 system, you can start build on it and add additional components to it and make it bigger for your home usages. And today, this mechanism is not there yet. I use this SmartSense because actually SmartSense is one of the most open platform that can include lots of things, but not everything can be included. Unless you like Bob, who write his own program, right? And then otherwise, it's not that scalable. And then scalability to the bigger one is the missing piece in the puzzle.
Work better. This is I'm saying it's the start of a multi-hour discussion, so I'll just bring it up. One of the points you're trying to make in my talk is that there's some fundamentally new thing about the internet, and Intel is still caught up in the old embedded system paradigm. And just to get one example here is that the idea that you have to build these systems together is all thinking that the big thing about the internet is you have a common transport when various solutions can coexist. And we're not even starting, and we're also peer connectivity. And we haven't started tapping into that thing and going back. With smart things, for example, is horrendous because, and that's what I mentioned in my book, the server somewhere is shared at Fuego. How do people even know where shared at Fuego is? For all I know, the server's there, and that's down, I can't open my door. So at this point, we're really playing with it, and we really have to think about this. So how do you create a process where disparate systems can start to work together without these central points?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you, Bob, for the additional comments. Okay, so I think time's up. Although I have six gifts, I think only 1, 2, 3, 4 people ask. Maybe people who ask two questions can get two gifts. Okay? Oh, there's one more. You want to give?
Okay, thank you for the opportunity. We know that the Internet of Things is recently emerging the interesting research. And in my idea, in Internet of in the, in the healthcare or biomedical application, it also can implement in the Internet of Things. But there is another thing in the healthcare, maybe some kind of regulation, because this is the biomedical information is a kind of private information. So my question is how far are you considering this kind of issue? Thank you.
Okay. Personally, I was talking to the TPC chair earlier. She wanted to ask me a question. She asked me which IoT application is my favorite. Right? Actually, I like this kind of healthcare as a very important next step. All my research is trying to do to help users. I think Bob also says that, right? I'll try to help people, the motivation research. And one of my motivations is health. I'm not a very healthy person, so that's why I'm very interested in health, all kinds of applications. Security, privacy, indeed is a big concern. Besides, you know, the FDA approval of all these devices, whether they can meet the medical grades, this kind of problem. And we have some ideas I'd like to share with you. Maybe you're able to help us. In this particular presentation, I talk about we call abstractions between the cyberspace and the physical space. And there's another abstraction you can consider. It's the abstraction between the insights. Insights means the most important information which you can take actions away from the physical data. Today, a lot of data is a problem that you really want to stream all the data to the cloud. And it's a security breach, your data is gone. Right, go to the bad people. But if you can only derive the inside part of it, consider if I put all the data in the encrypted domain, and then I have an encrypted domain processing algorithms that can go to check with the encrypted domain data. But the only output is only 0 and 1 and tell you, for example, oh, YK is having the flu, he has a fever. If I can do that, that will be good enough, because I never have all the data getting to the wrong hands, because it's all encrypted, nobody can read it. It's at this filter, and this filter only can tell me whether I'm sick or not. Okay? So this kind of domain, I think, is the first step that we are thinking about for moving forward to the next step, where you worry about privacy. Basically, you need this kind of data level abstractions, and you never give people the real data. You only tell people yes or no questions. And hopefully this will be eliminate more of the privacy concerns we talk about when we're collecting bio-signal data. I hope I answered your question. But I really like your question, so you can come here and get two gifts. Okay.
Time is overrun, so I want